this and amazed that you promised to restore and renew us through Christ. You are faithful to your covenant, the covenant you have made with us, a covenant ratified with your Son's blood. And we ask that you would open our eyes to see you for who you are, and that you are like no other. You have said, I am the Lord, and besides me, there is no Savior. And you are the Creator, and as your people, we owe our existence and our salvation to you alone. You are our Redeemer. Our debt became yours, and you paid it in full, ransoming us from captivity through the sacrifice of your Son. And you have called us by name, and we are yours. Your steadfast love assures us that no ultimate harm will come to us. And in Christ, we are your adopted children, and you will never leave us, you will never forget us, and you will never let us go. And we worship you, for you alone are worthy of our praise. And yet we have sinned against you. We have not kept ourselves from idols that promise everything and deliver nothing. Forgive us for looking for hope in people, or achievements, possessions, or favorable circumstances. You are the true fountain and source of life and our deliverer. Forgive us for turning from you to empty, useless, counterfeits, and false rescuers. Help us to see and uproot the idols of our hearts and to return to Christ, our first love. Forgive us for magnifying our disappointments and minimizing your goodness. Forgive us for belittling you in our minds and in our behavior. Forgive us for our lack of trust. Forgive us for our pride and self-dependence that blinds us to our inability to live apart from your grace. So we cry out for your mercy, O Lord. Father, we as a nation have forsaken your law, and we are reaping the consequences. Have mercy on us and turn us back to you. We see the corruption. We know that evil abounds, but by your grace and your mercy, you have given opportunity for repentance. So we pray that you would bring many to repentance. We pray that you would stand firm against evil and stay the flooding tide of immorality. We pray that you would empower families to stand firmly on your word and to disciple those that you have given to us. Father, we find comfort in the truth that you control the course of world events and are moving them toward their ultimate end. And we ask that you will reassure us that you are doing the same in our own circumstances, and that you will bring those of us whose faith is in Christ safely to your promised inheritance that will never fade or be lost. Help us to trust you and find comfort in the hope we have in Christ. And while we cry out, O wretched man or woman that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death, we can also cry out in worship, thanks be to God who gives us the victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. The death of your Son was the death of death, and he has defeated all enemies. And his resurrection is the guarantee of our own, and how we long for and look forward to that day, the day of Christ's return, and the eternal day of unspeakable joy when everything that is broken will be made new. God, you are the sovereign King, the Ancient of Days. You are loving to your children, but you are fearsome to your enemies. Cause your gospel to spread with power so unbelievers will seek you while you may be found and trust Christ for salvation. Father, we do pray for Operation Christmas Child and that ministry. We pray that through that ministry, many hearts will be won for Christ, that the seeds that have been sown will fall on fertile soil and grow up and reap a mighty harvest. We thank you that Goretti is here, and we pray for that ministry. Lord, you have blessed them, and you have ministered through them, and we pray for those who come under the umbrella of that ministry, that they would see their need for Christ and that they would be rescued from the paths that lead to destruction. Father, you are merciful, and we cry out for you to show great mercy there. Bless them and use them and empower them and provide for all of their needs. And we do think of our brothers and sisters who suffer for living out their faith. We pray that their witness and suffering will not be in vain, but will lead many, even their persecutors, to faith in Christ. Comfort them with the presence of your Spirit and be their stronghold in the day of trouble. Give them strength of faith and reveal your mighty power in their weakness for the glory of your name. And now, as your word is read and proclaimed, we need your help. Help us to hear, trust, and obey your voice of truth and grace, so we will become more like Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning is found in Isaiah chapter 25. Isaiah chapter 25, verses 1 through 9. Isaiah 25, verses 1 through 9. O Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you. I will praise your name, for you have done wonderful things. Your counsels of old are faithfulness and truth. For you have made a city of ruin, a fortified city of ruin, a palace of foreigners to be a city no more. It will never be rebuilt. Therefore, the strong people will glorify you. The city of the terrible nations will fear you. For you have been a strength to the poor, a strength to the needy in his distress, a refuge from the storm, a shade from the heat. For the blast of the terrible ones is as a storm against the wall. You will reduce the noise of aliens as heat in a dry place, as heat in the shadow of a cloud. The song of the terrible ones will be diminished. And in this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all people a feast of choice pieces, a feast of wines on the lees, of fat things full of marrow, of well-refined wines on the lees. And he will destroy on this mountain the surface of the covering cast over all people and the veil that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces. The rebuke of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. And it will be said in that day, behold, this is our God. We have waited for him, and he will save us. This is the Lord. We have waited for him. We will be glad and rejoice in his salvation. Amen.
We will be glad and rejoice in his salvation. We have every reason to praise the Lord, because his victory over death and sin is complete for us. That's our passage today. We're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 15. So if you will, please open your Bibles. 1 Corinthians 15, verses 50 to 58. And the theme of this text is the victory of Christ. His victory on our behalf is complete and it is total. So complete and so total that death is no longer death for us. I know this is everyone's favorite time of year, isn't it? This is tax season. You know, today's April 15th. Everyone's got this day on their calendar, don't they? April 15th, everyone's favorite day. And it's commonly said, you hear it all the time, that there's only two things in life that are certain, death and taxes, right? Well, our passage today contradicts that, because death is not so certain. Christ is the victor over death. And our passage, actually, it even teaches today that in Christ, there will be some who are exempted from death. So total and complete is Christ's victory over death on our behalf that there will be those who are exempted from death. So there's not two things that are certain. Maybe there's only one thing that's certain in this life is taxes. Because death is not so certain in Christ, because he is the victor over the grave. So let's read our text. This is 1 Corinthians 15, verses 50 to 58. So please stand one more time out of respect for God's word. We'll read it together. Now I say this, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead in Christ will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. This is God's word. You can be seated. Now you can see that the heart and soul of this text is this triumphant conclusion that thanks be to God who has given us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. This is the triumphant conclusion of the Apostle Paul's discussion of the doctrine of the resurrection. We've spent the last 6 weeks or so discussing chapter 15 of 1 Corinthians, and it's all about the resurrection and proving that it's true, and what does it mean? What would happen if the resurrection were not true? He discusses the resurrection from every possible angle, and our paragraph today is the triumphant conclusion of that discussion of praise and honor to Christ, who is the victor over sin and death. So this passage is driving, everything that is in this paragraph is driving to verse 57. That's the peak of the mountain, as it were. The focus of Paul's attention is on Christ's victory on our behalf. Now, in order to get there, in verses 50 to all the way through 56, there is a distinct logical chain, where each verse builds on the one that's previous, all building up to victory. Paul's thinking in this passage is, as I say, it is strictly logical. If you grant the assumption behind verse 50, then the assertion in verse 50 becomes clear. And if you understand verse 50, then verses 51 and 52 are obvious, the obvious implication. And if that's true, then verses 54 and 55 must necessarily follow. So each statement in this paragraph builds on the other as a tight logical chain. So if we're going to understand Paul's victory, we have to understand each of these statements in sequence. And if we're going to understand any of them, we have to have the same assumption that Paul has when he starts. That's the critical thing. We're not going to end up where he ends up worshiping God for his victory in Christ if we don't start with the same assumption he has at the beginning. So before we can even discuss verse 50, we have to ask ourselves, what is Paul's unstated assumption that's behind verse 50? When he says in verse 50 that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, he's assuming something about the nature of the kingdom of God that maybe not everyone in this room understands. So before we can understand the depth and the profundity of Christ's victory for us, the first thing we have to understand is something about God's kingdom. So that's what we're going to do. This sermon is going to progress in two stages. First, we will look at each statement in turn as it builds to Christ's victory, and then we will apply that. So the two halves of the sermon are Christ's victory for us is complete, and what does that mean for my life today? But before we can even do that, we have to start where Paul starts. And if we don't share his assumptions, we won't get where he's going. So what does Paul know about the kingdom of God that maybe you and I need to hear before we can appreciate Christ's victory for us? And it's simply this, that God's intention in his kingdom is eternal, and his intention is to share it with us for eternity. That's the implied understanding behind the kingdom of God that makes all of this become clear. That once you understand that God's intention in creating humanity was to share with us an eternal kingdom, then everything else about Christ's work becomes clear and obvious, and his victory becomes profoundly understandable. But where's Paul getting that assumption? As I say, he's not really stating it in verse 50. It's the unstated assumption behind verse 50, and he's getting that from the Old Testament. Turn over, before we can understand this, turn over to Daniel chapter 7, for example, to see the promise that God has given us when he promises us a kingdom. And we're going to read Daniel 7, verses 13 and 14, and verse 27. So Daniel 7, verse 13 and 14, Daniel has a vision in the night, and he sees this. Verse 13 says, I was watching in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man, coming with the clouds of heaven. He came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. Then to him was given dominion, and glory, and a kingdom, that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion, which shall not pass away. And his kingdom is the one which shall not be destroyed. So this is Daniel's prophetic vision of Christ ascending to the throne of God. And it's the kingdom of God is described here. And it's the eternal nature of the kingdom of God is the focus of this passage, where the Christ ascends to the throne of God, and the kingdom of God is transferred to Christ's authority, and that kingdom is described as an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away. It's the one kingdom that cannot be destroyed. In contrast to every other kingdom on earth, in contrast to the American Empire, in contrast to the British Empire, in contrast to the Roman Empire, in contrast to the Antichrist future empire, every earthly kingdom will be destroyed, but there is one kingdom that will last for eternity and can never be destroyed, and that's God's kingdom. And in this text, God's kingdom, you'll notice, is Christ's kingdom. The authority that God has over his eternal kingdom is given to Christ. Well, what does Christ do with it? Look down the page at verse 27. Then the kingdom and the dominion and the greatness of the kingdom under the whole heaven shall be given to the people, the saints of the Most High. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve and obey him. So this is what Paul knows about God's kingdom that forms the basis and the framework for everything he says about the victory of Christ, is God's kingdom is an eternal kingdom, and God intends to share his eternal kingdom with us, his saints. That's what verse 27 says. The kingdom, the dominion, the rule over all things, that rule that lasts for all eternity will be given, verse 27 of Daniel 7 says, that kingdom will be given to the saints of the Most High. What an amazing promise that you and I, one day in Christ, will inherit a kingdom that can never be destroyed, a kingdom that can never end. That's our inheritance in Christ. That's the promise of the Old Testament. And it's very clearly stated in the book of Daniel, although it's stated in maybe not in so clear terms throughout the Old Testament prophets. This is the promise that the Old Testament holds out, is not just that God is the king and that Christ is his agent for his rule. It's that rule is shared with everyone who belongs to Christ. Christ's kingdom is an eternal kingdom, and Christ's kingdom is ours, in him. What an astonishing promise that is. And friends, you must understand that was God's original intention in creating humanity from the very beginning. That when God created Adam and Eve and he put them in the Garden of Eden, he was intending for them to live forever with him, ruling his creation as the image of God. We were always intended to live forever with God. And the obstacle to that, the reason we're not doing that now, is because sin and death have intervened. Adam fell in the garden, and we were banished, as it were, from God's kingdom. We were separated from God's presence. Sin and death intervened and are keeping us from fulfilling right now the promise and the purpose for which God created us. We were made for God's kingdom. We were made to live in his presence for all eternity. But sin and death have driven a wedge between us and God. And the whole story of the Bible is the story of Christ's victory over sin and death. And how he, by defeating sin and death and defeating every obstacle that is between you and God, he fits you for his kingdom. The story of the Bible is the story of Christ's victory. And that is the assumption that the Apostle Paul is bringing to this text as he thinks about the resurrection. And as he describes, Christ's victory for us, he's beginning his thinking with that promise. The promise and the purpose of God in creating us is that we should live with him in his kingdom forever. That's why, now turn over to verse 50 of 1 Corinthians 15. That's why he says, verse 50, I tell you this, brethren, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. If, here's the way he's thinking, if God's kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, how can we inherit it when our bodies decay and die? Do you see that's the assumption? The assumption is God has created us for an everlasting kingdom, but we have sin in our bodies and we necessarily die because of our sin. How then can we inherit an eternal kingdom when our bodies are not eternal? That's the problem. So he says, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. That's the obstacle that arises. So then, how will that promise ever be true? If the promise and the purpose of God is that he's created us for his eternal kingdom, but our bodies are made of flesh and blood and they die, how will that promise ever come true? Well, the answer is clear, isn't it? God will have to give us a new body. We have to be given a new body. And that's why he says in verse 53, therefore it is necessary, this corruptible must put on incorruptible. This mortal must put on immortality. Why must this mortal body be changed into an immortal body? Is because God has promised us an everlasting kingdom. His kingdom is the one that shall never be destroyed, and he is going to share it with his saints. Therefore, God, in order to complete his promise, God is required to give us a new body. It cannot happen any other way. If, for example, like the Corinthians thought, see, the Corinthians think that your soul lives forever, but your body dies. Many of the Corinthians are doubting the resurrection because they think it's good enough. If your soul lives in eternity with God and your body, well, your body can just go and die in the dust. As long as your soul is with God, you're okay. And the Apostle Paul is saying, no. That if that were the case, then God is not the victor over death. If your body stays dead and your soul goes to heaven, and that's what the eternal state is like, understand this, death won. If your body stays dead, when God has promised you an everlasting kingdom and your body isn't there, then death is the victor, not God. So in order for God to be the victor, he has to give us a new body. That's the promise. And now if that's true, if it's true that God's kingdom is an everlasting kingdom and he's going to share it with us, then what else is true? Verse 51 and 52 is true. Everyone will be given a new body when Christ returns, whether you're alive or dead. This is the new doctrine that he's introducing us to that maybe we haven't heard before, or maybe you haven't considered before. It's this, that the promise of the resurrected body is so certain and true and so necessary that God will even give a resurrected body to those who are alive when Jesus returns. Everyone will get a resurrected body, whether you're alive or dead, when Christ returns. That's the promise of verse 51. Look at what he says. He says, behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we who remain, shall be changed. This is the doctrine that he's introducing, which is the necessary consequence of the fact that God has promised us an everlasting kingdom. If God has promised us an everlasting kingdom, then he needs to give us a new body. Well, to what extent is that promise true? Simply this: if you're alive when Jesus Christ shows up, you get your resurrected body in an instant. Before you can even blink your eye, God will be able to change this corrupted body into an everlasting resurrected body, even if you don't have to die. So that there, in other words, what he's saying here is that there are Christians who are living on the earth who might never die. If you are alive the day Jesus appears in the clouds, then you will never die. You will be exempt from death because you will be changed in an instant. And that word in verse 52, in a moment, it's a word in Greek that means an indivisible amount of time. In other words, the smallest chunk of time that such that you cannot divide a smaller piece of time. That's how quick the change will come. That literally, before you can blink your eye or before your eye can and move from one side of your head to the other, your body will be transformed. That's how fast God will do it. And you won't have to pass through the grave. And you, if you're alive when Christ returns, you won't have to die. So that is the promise, is that if he's going to give us a resurrected body, that's true of everyone who belongs to Christ, whether you're dead or whether you're alive when he returns. For the dead who belong to Christ, they will be raised when that trumpet sounds, and God will give them a new body, and they and their body and soul will be united with Christ. For us who, if any of us are alive and remain on that day, then we will be transformed instantly into our resurrected state, even if we haven't died. So since God's kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, then he must give us a new body, and he will give a new body to everyone, whether they're alive or dead. So what does that mean? It means that Christ and Christ alone is the victor over death. Isn't that what he says next? Since that's going to happen, this corruption must put on incorruption and this mortal must put on immortality, what does that mean? It means, the verse 54, that the statement in the scriptures has come to pass, namely, death is swallowed up in victory. Could there be any clearer demonstration of victory over death than those who have died being risen again? There could be. Here's an even clearer demonstration over victory over death, that some people who belong to Christ would never have to die. Do you see that the exemption from death that God offers to those who are alive when he returns is the clearest possible demonstration that Christ is the victor over death? How can death be the victor if Christ can exempt you from it? Who's really the master in that situation? It's Christ, and it's Christ alone. And the fact that God has ordained that it will only happen, that the resurrection of the body for believers will only happen when Christ appears in the clouds, is meant to demonstrate that he and he alone is the victor over death. And there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved than Jesus Christ. Only Jesus Christ is the one who can save us from death and sin. And that will be demonstrated tangibly and visibly to everyone on earth the day Christ appears in the clouds and everyone who belongs to him rises to meet him in the air, and those who are alive are instantly transformed and raptured to be with him. It will be clear to the entire universe that Jesus Christ and him alone is the victor over death. And he has the authority to bring people back to life, and he has the authority to keep you from ever dying in the first place. Because he alone is the Lord of the living and the dead. He is the King of kings, and he is the Lord of lords, and he is the victor over death. And the doctrine of the rapture is a significant doctrine to understand because it shows to us in the clearest terms possible that Christ and Christ alone is the one who defeats death. So if Christ is the victor over death, well, what does that mean? Here's the next logical chain in the chain of Christ's victory. We see that he is the victor over death. But what does it mean that he's the victor over death? He can only be the victor over death if he has already defeated sin. And that's what he says next, isn't it? Look at the text. He says, "O death, where is your sting? And O Hades, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin." How can death be defeated where sin still exists? The wages, the scripture says, the wages of sin is death. The reason people die is because we sin. That's the only reason. The reason our bodies get old is because of Adam's sin. The reason humanity is subject to death is because we are in Adam, and in Adam we all sin. Sin and death go hand in hand, like peas and carrots, if you're Forrest Gump, or like avocados and toast, if you're a hipster. They're inseparable. You can't separate sin and death. They go together, and sin is the cause of death, and death is the effect of sin. And understand this, if the effect has been nullified, it's because the cause has been nullified. If death no longer has dominion over you, that can only be true if sin has been removed from your life. So if, understand the logic of Paul here, if sin has been defeated, and Christ has defeated sin, Christ has defeated death. He defeated it on Easter. He will defeat it fully and finally on the day of his return. And if Christ is the victor over death, he can only be the victor over death if he has already defeated sin. And that's why he died on the cross. Christ died on the cross in your place to take the sin away from you and the wrath of God that you deserve for your sin away from you. And defeating death on the cross, he also defeated sin on the cross. And since sin has been removed by the blood of Christ, he says in our text that the sting of death is removed. What does he mean? What does he mean when he says sin is the sting of death? Here's what he means. The only reason death is a terror to us is because we're sinful. The reason people are afraid of death, the reason death is such a powerful sting, the reason it hurts so much or the reason it causes so much terror is because every one of us, every single person in this room knows in the back of your mind that the day you die is the day you stand before God. That's why death is terrifying. And the reason we're afraid to die is because we're afraid to stand before God and have to answer for what we've done in this life. Because every one of us knows, even if we don't want to admit it, every one of us knows that God will be able to look at our lives and evaluate us and condemn us for how we've lived. You say, well, but my good deeds outweigh my bad. But so what? Your good deeds are not good enough to please God, are they? And every one of us knows, even if we want to pretend that we're the best person in the world and we want to put a good face forward in public, every one of us knows down in the back of our brains, in the depths of our conscience, that we're accountable to Almighty God. And the day we die is the day we're judged. And that's why we're afraid to die. The reason death has a sting is because of sin. It is sin that causes us to fear death. It's sin that causes us to be afraid of crossing that border because we know that we're sinners. But friends, understand this. If Jesus has defeated death, he has defeated sin for you too. You see how he has taken away the sting of death. Death no longer has a terror for you if you belong to Christ. If you will repent of your sins and trust in Christ, he doesn't just give you the promise of everlasting life. He gives you the promise of everlasting life because he has already taken away the threat of everlasting death. You don't have to be afraid of death anymore. You don't have to grieve like those who have no hope. You don't have to be terrified because Christ has taken your sin in his body on the cross. It was nailed to the cross with Christ. When he died, your sin died with him. If you will repent of your sins and trust in Christ, you will be forgiven. And the sting of death is removed because your sin has been taken away from you. Trust in Christ, and he will bear your sin, and he will cast it as far away as the east is from the west, and it will no longer be a hindrance for your relationship with God. And the day you die is the day you see Christ, you see God face to face, and he says to you, well done, good and faithful servant, enter into the joy of your master. Christ has removed the obstacle that would keep you from God's kingdom. He's removed the obstacles that would cause you to be judged and condemned. He has not just defeated death. When he defeated death, he also defeated sin. He removed the sting of death, which is our sin. Well, if he's defeated sin, well, then what? If he can defeat sin, understand this, he can also remove sin's power over your life. Isn't that what he says, the next thing? That's the next link in the chain, is verse 56. The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. You understand that if Jesus is the victor over death, and he is the victor over sin, then he has the power to remove sin's dominion over your life. When he says in verse 56 that the power of sin is the law, he's talking about the fact that we, in our sinful nature, are enslaved to sin, and the law merely points out that fact. What God did when he revealed the law and he came down and Moses came down Mount Sinai with the tablets of the testimony and he showed us the Ten Commandments and he gave us all of these laws, what that does for the unbeliever is it simply reveals just how wretched a sinner you really are. Because it shows you that you have covetousness in your heart. It shows you that you have murder in your heart. It shows you that you have thieving in your heart. It shows you that you have adultery in your heart. And it exposes every corner of the soul. There's 300 and some odd commands in the Old Testament law, and every one of them we violate because we have sin within us. And the more we try to please God, the more we find that we just sin naturally. It just comes out of us, and we can't control it. We are under the dominion of sin in ourselves. But you understand this, that if Christ is the victor over death, and he is the victor over sin, he also removes from you the power of sin in your life. When you trust in Christ, he takes out your sinful heart and he gives you he takes out that heart of stone, that heart of rebellion, and he gives you a heart of flesh, a heart that is willing to obey, a heart that is willing to serve. He changes you from the inside out and he delivers you from the power of sin. You on your own are a slave to your own sinful desires. And there's nothing you can do to set yourself free, but Christ is the victor over death, he is the victor over sin, and he is your liberator. He sets you free from the power of sin in your life. It no longer has dominion over you. You no longer need to be a slave of your own passions and desires. You no longer have to be enslaved by the pleasures that make war on your own soul. Now you are free in Christ to serve God. You are free in Christ to live a holy life. You are set free from the power of sin by the power of Christ. He is the victor over sin and death, and that means you don't have to wait until the day he returns to begin to experience his victory over sin. You can have it in your life right now by faith. Trust in him right now, and he will begin to give you power over your sin. He will set you free from that slavery. Trust in him, and you will begin to experience the victory of Christ. And so understand the logic of Paul. If God has promised us an everlasting kingdom, he must give us a new body. How is he going to give us a new body? Christ is going to come and defeat death. If he can defeat death, what can he defeat? He can defeat sin. If he can defeat sin, what can he defeat? He can defeat the power of sin in your life. Well, then what do we say to that? Verse 57. Thanks be to God who has given us the victory in Christ. Do you see what he's saying in verse 57? If this is what Christ has done for us to fulfill God's purpose and God's promise, then Christ is the victor over every hindrance and every enemy that would keep you from God. He is the victor. His victory for us is total and complete. Every enemy is destroyed by the death and resurrection of Christ. Every hindrance is swept aside. Christ is the victor for us. His victory is complete and total, and there is nothing remaining for you to do to be fit for God's kingdom. Only trust in him and find your victory in Christ. So as we follow the links in every chain, we see, as we follow Paul's reasoning and we follow his logic, we can see that Christ is the victor over every enemy of God's people. And there is nothing standing between you and God that Christ cannot destroy. He utterly annihilates every obstacle from your relationship to God. And that means there's nothing you need to do to please God except to trust in Christ. Everything has been accomplished. He has finished it all. Trust in him and in him alone. So Christ is our victor, and his victory for us is complete. Now, what do we do with that? He gives us three ways to live in light of Christ's victory. So briefly, we'll look at three applications or three ways to live in light of Christ's victory. The first one is obvious, verse 57. Thanks be to God who has given us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. If Christ's victory doesn't motivate you to worship, nothing will. If you can't look at Christ on the cross and see his death and resurrection as the solution to the deepest need of your soul, then nothing else will cause you to worship. If that doesn't stir your heart to praise your Savior, then what will? Christ is, he's not just the victor, he's your victor. He's your Savior. And as you trust in him, we realize that we have every reason to praise him because he has done everything we need. He has defeated every enemy. He has swept aside every obstacle. He has, in exchange for our sin, given us righteousness. He has done everything he needs to, everything that needs to be done to prepare us to live in eternity in heaven with God. Christ has done. Thanks be to God. We receive that gift with thanksgiving, and we live a life now of worship because of who Christ is for us. He is our King of Kings. And the only thing that is keeping you out of God's kingdom is time. And time is not an enemy. So we praise God. We live a life of worship for Christ's victory. We also live a life boasting in the face of death. The second application here is not only do we praise God for Christ's victory, we boast in the face of death. Isn't that what he says in verse 55? O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? What is Paul doing but teaching us to brag about the fact that we're going to die? To boast in the fact that we are going to die. We boast in the face of death because we know that the death for the believer is no longer a terror. It is merely the door that leads us to our reward. It's merely the transition that takes us into God's presence. It's not something to fear. It's not something to flee. It's something to boast in. We boast in Christ's victory because he has defeated death for us. We now boast about where we're going. We replace our fear of death with our confidence in Christ. And so, and that boasting is true not only of those who are in the process of dying. That boasting is true of those who are in the process of being left behind. Because the sting of death is totally removed. And you, as you age, do not need to fear death. And you, as you watch your loved ones die, do not need to fear death because you know where they're going. And you can even be happy when you begin to lose your loved ones because you know they're going to their reward. And you know you're going to see them again. We boast in the face of death. We don't grieve like those who have no hope. We praise the Lord and we're confident in the face of death. So thirdly, we not only praise the Lord and thank him for his victory in Christ, but we boast in the face of death. And verse 58, we increase our service for the Lord. Isn't that what he says? So then, here's the ultimate conclusion of Christ's victory for us is, so then, brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Since we know that he is coming and we know he's going to share with us his eternal kingdom, we know that there's a reward for our service for him today that motivates us not just to keep serving, that motivates us to increase serving. Isn't that what he says in verse 58? Of always abounding in the work of the Lord. What that means is always increasing in the work of the Lord. Serving him more, spending more energy, spending more time, spending more money to serve, to give. Increasing our service to God, always abounding in it more and more and more because we know the more we serve him, the more reward we have on the other side. The more people we win to Christ, the more souls we save, the more wisdom we share, the more we will shine like the stars forever and ever in the presence of Almighty God. There is a reward in his kingdom, and we know that Christ has done everything that's needed to bring us there. So then we know that there is a reward on the other side of this life, and nothing we do for the Lord is wasted. But all of it will be rewarded. There's no room for discouragement. There's no room for giving up because Christ has already won. There's no defeat. There's no failure for a believer. There's only the reward with Christ on the other side. And so we, instead of being discouraged, instead of losing heart, instead of giving up, we double down and we serve more. More persecution, more service. More hindrance, more service. Because we know that the more we serve him, the more he will reward us for. And nothing done for the Lord in this life is ever wasted. He will repay it. So we increase our service for him. We labor harder for the Lord, knowing that the greater is our reward in heaven. As the book of Daniel says, those who win many sinners will shine like the stars forever and ever in the kingdom of God. So God has, the victory of Christ has given us every reason to praise him and every reason to serve him. He is our victory. Let's pray together. Almighty God, we thank you for the power and the victory of Christ. Lord, I pray that if there's anyone in this room that doesn't know you, that they would come to know you by faith and experience victory through Christ. We ask this in his name. Amen.
Let's stand together. We're closing an old hymn, when we all get to heaven, because it'll be a great day, won't it?
Amen.
It could happen any minute. We're just taken out. But, you know, when we see Jesus face to face, everything will become in full view of what has been happening here on earth while we continue to serve him. Let's sing the first and the fourth verse.
Wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon his beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
That'll be a great day. Amen? Looking forward to it, Andy.
Now receive this benediction. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful, who will also do it. Amen.